played, as well as the offertory and the postlude today, are all pieces that are in our hymnal, but actually are from around the world. So I hope you will appreciate the world tour that Randy is taking us on today, as well as the other musical gifts that will be part of our gathering this morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The folks who are rejoicing on this World Communion Sunday is the fact that you are here to worship Almighty God with us. And on behalf of our session, it's my joy to welcome each one of you and thank you for being a very special part of our worship service on this Lord's Day. I invite you to see on the inside row to find out this maroon folder. Inside it is our fellowship pad. If you take a moment to sign that, pass along the other good folks that are sitting there with you. As it comes back here to the pew, please note those names and take a moment at the end of our service to greet each other in a personal way. We welcome all who are visiting with us today. It's a great help if you would include, along with your name, a telephone number or an email address, somewhere we might be back in touch to affirm the fact that you have worshiped with us this morning. And a very special welcome to those who are worshiping with us today and seeking a church home in this community. We would be honored to explore that possibility with you. There's a place to indicate your desire to join this church on the fellowship pad. Or feel free, again, to speak with me or one of our elders at the end of the service today. We have two inserts in the bulletin this morning. One is the words of the choir's anthems. Notice I had an S on that. We'll have an anthem in the scripture readings that emphasizes one of the psalm selections for today, Psalm 137. And then just before communion, or just before the great prayer of Thanksgiving, we'll have a communion anthem. So I thank the choir for their extra work of making these anthems possible. And at the end of the service, you're going to be invited to join with us in the choral response, and you'll find those words on the back of the insert. So please keep that insert handy as we move through the worship service this morning. The other insert is just as it says. There's still time, if you haven't made your appointment to have your picture made for our new upcoming pictorial directory, there's still time to get that appointment made. Let me invite one of our deacons, Mindy Cardwell, to stand right out here so you can put a face together with that. If you haven't made your appointment, Mindy will be glad to talk with you either today or you can give her a phone call. We want everybody to be included in the pictorial directory, as many as possible. Our special bulletin cover reminds us that it is World Communion Sunday. We have a painting there of Jesus and the disciples at the tables, an international painting. And you are all encouraged to be an active part of our World Communion Sunday. We will be taking the Lord's Supper here at the communion table. You'll be encouraged to come forward and pick up a piece of the flat bread and dip it into the grape juice and then partake of both elements together. When the time comes, there will be two stations here at the front of the church. The choir will go first. And after they've been served, then you'll simply come down the center aisle as you are able and return to your seats by the side aisle. Any that can't come forward, we'll be glad to bring the elements to you after the others have been served. But hopefully everyone will participate in communion this morning. Part of World Communion Sunday, as you've seen in the announcements that we've had in recent weeks, is we collect a peace and global witness offering for our Presbyterian Church. You'll find these brown envelopes in the pew rack this morning. I hope you have come prepared for it, but if you haven't, carry one of these envelopes home with you, and you can bring it back next Sunday, or you can mail it to the church. A portion of this offering stays right here in our county as we work with young people about how they can have peace in their lives, and the other a portion goes to our presbytery and to the national efforts that work internationally around the world for peace and global witness. Again, please give generously to that offering as the plate is passed this morning. I want you to continue in prayers for our officers elect, the deacons elect, and the elders elect. We'll meet this afternoon at 2 o'clock and begin their study together as we prepare for them to be the most effective officers they can be beginning in January. So please keep these men and women in your prayers. Also remind the deacons that they have a meeting tomorrow afternoon at 5:30, and we look forward to that meeting. The Presbyterian Women's Circles will meet this week. You'll see the time for their meetings in your bulletin. Please get involved with this continuing study of the Ten Commandments. And right at the end of our worship service this morning, the Presbyterian Women are encouraged to come over to this side of the front of the sanctuary for a brief meeting, as you'll be voting on some changes to your bylaws. I think this was mentioned at the last circle meetings, and today is the day to vote. So Presbyterian Women that are in attendance this morning are again encouraged to gather here at the front of the church for a brief meeting at the end of our worship service this morning. Prayers for those who will be attending next Saturday's gathering of the Coastal Carolina Presbytery. Please keep commissioners from our church and across the Presbytery in your prayers as they meet at First Presbyterian Church of Dunn next Saturday morning. At this time, Robin Fort, our choir director, has some information, our music director, excuse me, has some information to share with us about our meeting this morning.
You probably have not noticed yet in your order of service that the choral response has become a congregational response. Now, don't worry if you missed choir practice Thursday night. I didn't see most of you there. But it is simply repeating the third verse of our second hymn. So, it's on the back, as John mentioned, it is on the back of your handout. So, right there, ready for you to sing along on response. Now, some of you are really going to enjoy singing with the choir, and you're asking, how can I continue that? Well, we're starting Christmas music this week. Yes, I know it's October, but it's just 2 months away. Some of you might like to join us on the Christmas music. Try the choir out for a couple of months. Now is your time to do it. We begin rehearsals at 7 o'clock this coming Thursday. Come give us a try.
Thank you, Robin. And now I invite you to take your bowls and enjoy with me the call to worship that's printed there. Let us read these lines responsibly. Listen, O people, for the word of God. Listen, O people, for the word of God. Listen, O people, for the word of God.
Thank you.
learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Let us ask God to forgive us as we join together in the prayer printed in our bulletins. Let us pray. God, the maker of all things good, have mercy upon your creation. We gather on Sundays to nourish our faith, but we find the seeds scorched in the light of Monday morning. We want to bear fruits of compassion and kindness, but we fall into selfish habits, and our discipleship withers. Forgive us, God of mercy. Shower us with your grace, and free us to try again.
Amen.
Hear the good news. If we have died with Christ, we shall know that we shall also live with him. So you must consider yourselves dead to sin, and alive to all that is good in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Good and generous God, we thank you for the privilege of gathering in your house today. We thank you for the invitation to gather around your table to receive the gifts you have for us. And now we pray, O God, that you receive these gifts that we've brought to honor you, to thank you for the love that surrounds us every day, and to ask that you might use these gifts here within our community and around the world to show the hope of Christ to those who may be lost, to those who may be wondering if anyone does care for them. Help us to keep caring for one another and all that you present before us. It's in Christ's name that we make all of our gifts to you. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. This time we welcome Joyce Winkler to come forward to share a message with the children. Down on the steps. Come on up, guys. Service when we open our Bibles and anticipate having God's Word read to us. I would invite you to join your heart with mine as we share in a prayer for illumination, that we might all be a little better listeners on this Lord's Day. Let us pray. God of our land, God of the Holy Land, God of all nations, we await your good gifts again today. As we listen for your word and prepare to come to your table, surround us with your Holy Spirit. Give us courage, give us compassion as we worship together. For it is in the living name of Jesus Christ that we listen. Amen. Both our Old Testament reading and our Psalm selection come from the small book that follows the book of Jeremiah in our Bibles, the book of Lamentations. Five chapters, five poems that cry out to God for help. In 586 BC, Jerusalem was conquered by the Babylonians. The temple was destroyed, and many were carried off into exile. Here is a tragic picture of what was left behind, beginning at the first verse of the first chapter of Lamentations. How lonely sits the city that once was full of people. How like a widow she has become, she that was great among the nations, she that was a princess among the provinces, has become a vassal. She weeps bitterly in the night with tears on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she has no one to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone into exile with suffering and hard servitude. She lives now among the nations and finds her resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her in the midst of her distress. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate, her priests groan, her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters, her enemies prosper, because the Lord has made her suffer. For the multitude of her transgressions, her children have gone away captives before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princes have become like stags that find no pasture. They fled without strength before the pursuers. The tears and the pain fall off the page. Lamentations is written like a poem, like a song. It is hard, heartbreaking reading. Yet in the middle of chapter 3, we find a glimmer of hope. Listen as I begin at verse 19 of the 13th, of the third chapter of Lamentations. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me, but this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Still, we wait. God be with us. lyre and cello help us in our waiting. Today's gospel lesson finds Jesus and his disciples continuing their faithful journey to Jerusalem. The disciples, or apostles as they are called here in Luke chapter 17, have been impressed with Jesus' wisdom and miracle-working power. They have another request. Listen. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron, and serve me while I eat and drink? Later, you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" May God help us to do what we ought to do. Have you ever felt like throwing yourself a pity party? When nothing seems to be going right, when it feels like the whole world is against you, before you begin that party, I urge you to read the Old Testament book of Lamentations once again. As we heard the opening verses, the beautiful city of Jerusalem has been overrun by foreigners. The temple has been destroyed. There's no reason for pilgrims to come and visit. And if they did, there would be no food for them in that destroyed city. The prophetic warnings about God's coming judgment has been ignored for as long as, and the leadership knows that the judgment was deserved. And yet, there's no thing to say to God except, "Help us." This is a tough text to read anytime, but especially on World Communion Sunday, where can we find some good news in Lamentations? We get a little glimpse of that in chapter 3 in today's psalm reading. The destroyed city's pity party is in full swing, yet the psalmist, the poet, is bold to declare in verse 22, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." In the midst of the weeping and the wailing, we discover the source for that beautiful hymn, "Great is thy faithfulness." Have you ever heard it? Sure you have. It was our opening hymn today. Even in the midst of God's anger over our sinful and prideful ways, we still believe in the ultimate goodness and love of our Creator God. So always invite God to your pity party. You may be angry at God, ready to blame God for all of your problems. Go ahead. The God we believe in has big shoulders. God can handle all of our anger and our frustrations. God will listen, and God will still welcome us at this table. God is not driven away by all of our lamentation. God waits patiently for our faithful return. Where else can we go? In today's gospel lesson, we find the disciples going to Jesus with a request for their loving teacher to increase their faith. Have you ever made a similar request? "God, I'm not sure I have enough faith to get through this. Can't you find someone with more faith to take this on?" Do you have enough faith? Could you use a little more? the disciples asked Jesus to increase their faith, and Jesus told them to invest the faith they had in God's ability to do amazing things. If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, surely we have that much faith, don't we? That's all it takes with God's help to work miracles. It's not the size of our faith, but the amount of our trust in God's ability to use the faith we have for the glory of God. Too often, we get caught up in the belief that bigger is better. Gotta have the biggest house, drive the finest car, make the most money. These pursuits always lead to pity parties, always end in lamentation about not having enough. Read your Bibles again. Notice how God uses the least of these again and again. Gideon was a wimp, but with God's help, Gideon defeated the invading army, as we read in the Old Testament. God told Samuel that one of Jesse's sons would be the next king of Israel. Samuel thought certainly it would be that tall and handsome firstborn son, but it wasn't. Well, surely one of these other strapping young men standing with us will be the next king of Israel. It wasn't. God had God's eye on young David, still out in the field tending the sheep. God often works with the least of these. And when it came time for God to choose someone to give birth to God's beloved son, was it a princess or a powerful businesswoman? No, it was a teenager who wasn't even living in the holy city of Jerusalem. God can take what faith we have and change the world. You have enough faith. We have enough faith. What we need is more trust in God's ability, God's willingness to work with the faith we have to make God's love known all over the world. We're invited to a party today. Not a pity party, but the great banquet of remembrance for what Jesus Christ has died for all of us. What Jesus Christ has done for all the world. Almighty God has planted the seeds of faith in all of us, and Jesus has nurtured these growing plants. With God's help, everything is possible. Enough faith to move mountains. Enough faith to forgive those who have wronged us. Enough faith to love our enemies, and together to fashion a better world for all of God's children. Lamentations will continue, but God's mercies are fresh every morning. You are invited to the Lord's table again this morning. Bring the faith you have. It is enough. With God's help, it is always enough. And may we give the glory to God. God, we know, is our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. Amen. Having heard God's Word read and proclaimed, we respond as people of faith by sharing together what we believe. I invite you to take your hymn book and turn with me to page 34, there near the front of the hymn book. And then to stand with me as together we share the Nicene Creed. Let us stand. Let us confess the faith of the universal church.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one being with the Father, through him all things.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the Lord. In the scriptures we read that in the kingdom to come, people will gather from north and south and east and west and come to the Lord's table for a celebration. We symbolize that journey by our own gathering in this, the Lord's house today. We've come from our various communities, our various homes, and here we are welcome at the Lord's table. Again, I remind you that all baptized members of this congregation who have expressed an interest in receiving the Lord's Supper are welcome at this communion table. All community members of any other Christian congregation are welcome at this, the Lord's table. We pray that you will stay with us and commune with us this morning. I remind you, my friends gathered here in Shiloh, as Paul reminded his friends gathered in Corinth so long ago, that on the night our Lord was betrayed and arrested, he took bread and broke it. And he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Whenever you eat of this, do it in remembrance of me." And likewise, after the supper, our Lord took a cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink of it, do it in remembrance of me." For Paul reminds us that as often as we eat this bread and share this cup, we will proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. Indeed, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Now we give our attention to the choir and their second anthem. Let us pray. God of grace and peace, we humbly thank you for the gift of your creation. You alone designed the universe, bringing order out of chaos, creating the sun and the moon, the sea and the land. You made humankind in your own image, called us your children, that we might live together in peace. You gifted us with the law and the freedom to choose a faithful life. Hardened hearts and closed minds turned us away from you, yet even as we sinned, you stood before us with open arms, calling us home to you. As a symbol of your abiding love, you set before us the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the presence of Christ for your people in every corner of the world. We thank you and praise you for the glory of all you have created. We lift our voices in joyful praise. Loving parent, we praise before you the wisdom and your power that draws us ever closer to you. We are eternally grateful that you sent your only Son to live among us. He came to heal those whose lives were broken, yet he suffered greatly. He came with a pure heart, untouched by sin, and made friends with sinners, giving his life so they might be freed from sin. With a life more powerful than death, he quietly surrendered his spirit. We thank you for his presence among us still, our life made new by the cross. We trust his power to overcome all that could separate us from your love, and will stand fast, confident that he will come again in glory. As we break this bread and share this cup, we give thanks for your redemptive love in Jesus Christ. Just as our Lord broke free from the bond of death, we too are renewed to live joyful and obedient lives, committed to fulfilling your vision of justice and peace in this world. God of wonder and grace, send your Holy Spirit to be among us, and with these gifts of bread and wine, sanctify them that they might be holy gifts, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of Christ Jesus. Grant that all who share the bread and lift the cup throughout the world this day will become one body and one spirit, living faithfully, healing all divisions, and joyfully proclaiming the wonder of your ways. Gracious Spirit, remember the Church universal. Unite her people, uphold their faithful witness, and nurture them in your ways of peace. Hear us, loving God, as we join in the prayer Jesus taught to his first disciples. Be among us as we pray together our Lord's Prayer, praying aloud, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite the elders forward who will assist in the communion. Once we have been served, and the choir has been served, you'll come down the center aisle and return by the side aisle.